going to waste any more time. Let's get him up here. John Barrowman! Hello! How are you? Oh, Dallas, oh, Dallas, I love Dallas. I'm moving the table. I don't know. I was a huge, well, sorry, not that any of you care about this, because it's not just all about sci-fi. I was a huge fan of the show Dallas when I was a kid. And yeah, so to come back always to Dallas is always a good thing. Hello in the front row. Why are there empty seats over there? If there are people waiting outside to get in and they want to come in, bring them in and put them in those empty seats. They're letting people in. I just like to go right to questions because I feed off of you guys. I have a good time, and hopefully you'll have a good time. Sometimes it's a bit PG-13, so I apologize right now, but I am what I am and I speak my mind, okay? And if you gotta explain anything to the kids, that's gonna make such a good ride home. What did he say, Daddy? Shut up. Don't worry about it. Okay, so I'm gonna interrupt your questions. Yes. Just pull it down, sweetheart. Just pull the mic out of there. Tick. Thank you. Thank you for helping her. Go ahead.
From the Doctor Who show or the Torchwood show, which was your favorite episode so far?
I never answer favorite questions. Seriously, because once I say what's my favorite, that's it. It's done. I can never change my mind. So I never say what is my favorite show, whatever my favorite, so any of you who are gonna come up and say what's your favorite song, what's your favorite this, don't ask it. But I have had a lot of episodes that were really good and real, a lot of fun to be in. In particular, I love the episodes. Of course, the first episode where Captain Jack appeared, the empty child, and Dr. Who. In Torchwood, I have to say, the entire, all of the series and every episode is a love of, they're loves of mine, because they're mine. The show is mine. You know, it was created for me, so I can't fault any of them. Even if some of you do, you can just piss right off. I don't give a shit. Is that all right? Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Yes. I'm going back and forth just so sound go. I'm going left to right. Yes. Her mic's not on. Hold on, sweetheart. Now try it. Here, ask your question.
Thank you so much for being
this one.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Go ahead. Don't squeak too much. Wiping things up over there. Oh, like you didn't think I was gonna go there. What's your question?
Thank you so much for being here. It means a lot to me. I heard you talk in Chicago, and it was just amazing to hear everything you were saying. I've been having some troubles, and you've really helped me out a lot. Like, I thought I was kind of a freak and that I should change for not being straight or cisgendered, and I was trying to change, and you really, sorry, my voice.
That's okay, this is the Oprah moment. This is your Oprah moment. Keep going. I'm not Dr. Phil because I ain't that big and ugly. And sometimes I want to punch him in the mouth. Don't you? Shut the up, Dr. Phil. Nobody cares about your opinion. Anyway, go ahead. Awesome.
Helped me out a lot.
Awesome. Well, are you done or is there more?
Do you mind singing for us?
I always love how it's you helped me out in my life. I didn't know I was probably gay. Da 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 da. Oprah moment. Can you sing for me? First of all, the first part of your question, I say, and I know I was quoted, and I probably will get the quote wrong, but don't ever apologize for being a nerd, but, you know, what is it? Someone know the asshole line. Who? Anybody? Go.
It's don't apologize for being a nerd,
don't
apologize for being an asshole.
Right, don't apologize for being a nerd, because people don't apologize for being assholes. And it's the same way. Never apologize for being gay or for who you are, because you know what? We are no different than anybody else, and the world is going to change because we are going to be treated equally. And I'm one who's going to fight for you, stand up on my feet, and make sure. Because in no way is somebody going to tell me that I am any less of a person or deserve anything less than somebody else, and I'm not going to stand for it, and neither should you. So good on you. What do you want me to say?
Pray Diver Hitler!
No, I'm not saying this, Pray Diver Hitler! Only in Dallas would you ask me to sing that, for God's sake. I was in Germany, and I was doing a con in Germany, and they're saying, Mr. Barrowman, this is my German accent, it's really good. Mr. Barrowman, I wonder if you could sing Springtime for Hitler for us. I said, what, you want me to sing that in Germany? Are you crazy? That would be all over the press, can you imagine? No way! I remember when we were filming the movie and we were in New York in Brooklyn, and in the side of Brooklyn where we were, they didn't tell us, but we were rehearsing in this big parking lot. There's about 200 Nazis in the parking lot giving all the... Right? And when I look around, I'm talking to a couple people, I go around to the fence, and there's all these Hasidic Jews standing watching us. When I'm put on the spot, I know I sing a lot of songs, but I don't know really what to sing. Sing who? Sing Star Wars. Da, 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 da. Wait. Stop. Where's Barbara?
Dreamer.
Barbara. Oh, you don't know who Barbara is? Barbara and I go way back. Barbara, stand up, Barbara. Barbara started to come and see me when I was in musical theater in 1989, right at the beginning. Miss Saigon, actually, so it was right after. And I've known her kids, and I think Scott's over there, is he? Wave? Yeah, since they were yay high. And that's one of the reasons I came to Dallas. You never knew I had a girl in Dallas, did you? Me and Barbara, husband never knew, did he? He was too busy playing golf. I like him too. Let me just tell you, they're a good Texas family. Hospitality. What should I sing? Dreamers? Okay, this is a very simple song. Dreamers have mountains they will climb. There are dreamers who don't believe in time. Only dreamers have dreams where they can fly far away. Some people dream of being rich, while others dream of being tall. And there are people who don't dream at all. Big finish. Sometimes you need to take the time. and mountains you can climb, and maybe you dream to stay the way that you feel. Cause to dreamers, the real world can be unreal. Trust me, I know, because I'm a dreamer. He is the face of Bone. Well, I say he is. When David and I were filming that episode, Russell, obviously we get the scripts ahead of time, and we, you know, like to read them and check out what's going on, and I hadn't read it yet. David came into my trailer, all of a sudden I heard this. I went, what? I said, John, have you read it? Have you read it? Next day at lunch, he comes back up to the trailer and goes, John, have you read it? Have you read it? David, I haven't read it yet. You won't believe it. Shut up, don't spoil it for me. No spoilers. So I have my lunch, I sit down, I read the script. We said nothing to each other, we just stood there going, ooh. One of the most amazing things that I rang Russell, I'm like, Russell, hey, what's going on? What the hell were you smoking when you wrote that? Facebook, not in that area. Yes, Facebook, what's really interesting and lovely about that is that Jack never, sorry, the doctor, I'm so out of breath now. I can't blame it on altitude in Dallas because it's as flat as a freaking pancake here. The doctor never agreed with who Jack was or what he was, right? And I know my story, Mugs. And the irony is that he was going to Jack for advice, for information, for ways in which to save human race, other races, and that was just a nice little twist that they did, so thank you very much. Yeah. Yes.
Hi, what was your reasoning and inspiration to do the dance for all the single ladies? And
the dance. And what?
And could you do the dance?
No. Are you kidding? I can't even breathe right now. The single ladies actually came about. I did not do that. I did not do a dance to single ladies. Those were outtakes. All of those different dances, all that kind of stuff, was all me being silly between takes on a TV show that I produced for the BBC, one of my own shows, called Tonight's the Night. And the guys that do that, they started their own digital graphics company. And they took it and they said, can we do a little video as an homage to you and the show and something fun, and also use it to promote our company? And I'm like, yeah, thinking, no big deal. Viral. It's like the most popular video of mine around, and that's how it came about. It's different dances, different sections, all spliced together, two single ladies. I never danced it full like that at all. But everyone thinks I did, and aren't I good?
Someone asks me, who's John Barrowman? I just show them that video, but just watch this.
Say again?
Anytime someone asks, who's John Barrowman? I said, just watch this video.
Oh no, don't just show them that video.
No, I'll show them other ones.
Yeah, please show them other ones. There's some really good ones. You gotta look for those.
One thing.
How many questions are you gonna ask?
No, last thing. Real quick, hopefully, real soon, equality, man.
Yeah. Well, I hate to tell you this, it's happening in other states, but it ain't happening in Texas yet, so you gotta fight harder. Yeah. Yes.
How'd you feel when you heard that you were gonna get your background show called Torchwood.
Yo-ho! Well, how did I feel? It was actually both a sad moment and a very happy moment, because I was obviously in Doctor Who at the time, and Julie Gardner, our producer, was, everybody was in the offices, for the Doctor Who offices at the BBC. And there was the 7/7 bombing that afternoon. So London got bombed by the terrorists and the buses and the tube stations. And I was doing a cabaret show that night at one of the big cabaret venues in central London. All of the West End shows shut down, and no one had any shows. I decided to do mine. I kept mine open because I believe that even if something tragic as it was, and horrific as it was, and how evil those people were, that you still need to move on and live with your life and show them that they will not stop us, right? So I did the show. And everybody came. Everybody showed up. It was amazing. It was in more ways than one, everybody showed up. Yes, they did. And I put on a big special performance for them. So Julie Gardner was coming that night to tell me I didn't know that I was getting my own show, Torchwood. So it was a mixed bag of emotion. And after the show, she came, before the show, we had dinner. And we're sitting talking, she said, John, it's been going really well. We want to continue Captain Jack's life. And I thought, well, they're gonna tell me that they're gonna put me in more episodes of Doctor Who. And they said, no, we're gonna give you Torchwood. And I was like, show my excitement, because also she said, don't tell anybody. So I had to go on and do the show that night, knowing that information, not telling anybody. But I did text Scott, obviously. He was there. I told him after the dinner. And then Julie actually rode onto the back of Scott's motorcycle, and I got some bribery for her, because it's a great shot. She's got a mini skirt on, she gets off the motorcycle, and it's like Britney Spears all over again. Anyway, thank you. Yes.
Hi. First, I want to thank you for doing Captain Jack. It was because of you that got me into the new reboot of Doctor Who. Because I was so trepidatious about the reboot. I didn't know if my childhood heroes would come back great. And I'm an idiot because Russell T. Davies is awesome. But my question to you is, which I just forgot.
See, sometimes it's not so good to do the little prolonged preamble before the question.
Oh, now I got it. Good. Okay. What's going on right now, and when will you be back in Doctor Who?
What do you think what's going on right now? Like, right now, we're in a big room with lots of people, and I'm doing a panel.
So you know my name already?
No. Okay. No, but I can time travel back in time 5 minutes. Find your name, I'll come back and tell you.
I'd say wait, it's time travel.
So you want to know what's going on right now?
When will you be back?
I have no idea. It's not a question to ask me.
Is there anything going on?
I am not in control of that. Right. It's the BBC who are in control of that. And it's also the writers and the new producers who are in control of it. And I've always said I would love to be asked back, because I adore playing Captain Jack. It's a role that changed my life and changed a lot of people's lives. And it's up to them. So the people who are really also in control are the fans, who can write and ask. And it's up, they might just not ever do it, but that's their prerogative. It's a drama, things change. But even Arrow has said to me, if they ask you to go back, we'll let you go back and do it. So everyone's kind of game and open to it. But I would love to.
Yeah, we'd love to see you there.
Awesome, great. Next question. Yes, TARDIS.
This is going to be very awkward, because I was going to ask basically what JP just asked.
You stole her question! Yes.
But, anyways...
Do you want us to have a moment to think about a new question? That might be a yes, right?
Nah.
No, you got one already. Okay, go ahead.
I'm not going to ask a question, but I'm just going to say that I'm very honored that you came here today, and I like your character.
You like my hair?
No, your character.
My character. Thank you very much. Come over here, because I always have to do this to TARDISes. Or TARDIs. Because I'm the only one who ever was on the outside. dresses, don't get up now. Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm really nervous right now.
Don't be nervous, just hold the microphone up to your mouth. Just, yeah, tend it to me. Please tell me you're 18. What's your question, dear? Say again?
You're fabulous and I love you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
The weirdest thing that's ever happened on a set of a TV show?
The weirdest thing of a TV show? Well, it's I'll tell you what, I've got a really good story, but I'm not going to answer it with you because you're 13 years old, so flip that, think of another question, flip that question over here and I'll pretend somebody asked it over here, right, sir? What's the weirdest thing, did you say, out of a TV show? Just say it for me.
What's the weirdest thing that happened to you when you're filming a TV show?
Thank you! Wow! I'm notorious on Torchwood for exposing things. And every time Eve Miles would be doing her close-up and we would have a scene together, every single time I would do it in my coat with my pants unzipped and just standing there going like that. And she would look at the camera and she'd go, she'd finish her big long dialogue speech with blah, 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 Jack, and then she'd go, has he got his bits out again? The best scene that I ever did though, where I thought I had the best time, was when, remember when Yanto was pushing Jack in a block of cement off of the cliff to smash it to save him, right? Well, I had to be stark naked, stark, we say in England, stark all naked in that, right? But you have these little things to cover up your patches, but none would fit. So, I would, are you getting all this, you right there? You getting it all? I'm gonna try to make it so difficult for you doing the signing. Yes, sign this. Come on, get up, stop, do it. So I fall out the block, boom, I'm supposed to get up, I'm supposed to stand there, and they're supposed to drive around the corner in a car, I'm there starting bald naked, and they're supposed to walk towards me like, Jack, you're saved, and I'm supposed to go be like, oh, thank goodness. But instead, I tell the camera crew, don't say anything, I'm not going to wear anything, right? Not going to wear anything, and give me some of those mittens, because I'm going to warm it up a little. And watch their faces as they turn. If you go back and look at that scene, I get up and I stand, and all of a sudden the car comes around. Well, Eve gets out of the car, she shuts the door and she goes, Gareth gets out and goes, and Kai Owen, who plays Eve's husband on the show, goes, because not only am I standing there naked, everything flapping about, but I, we're in a quarry with rocks and water, and it's health and safety, and they don't want me to hurt my feet, but there's nothing to put on my feet, because you can see shoes, and they don't want you to see the shoes, so I put maxi pads on my feet. Look at my feet! Look at my feet! And they're soaking up water. They can hold a lot of That's a joke for the ladies. Not for you, Barbara, that was a long time ago, wasn't it? Oh, shut up, she knows me so well. Anyway, so that was one of the moments. Thank you, sir, for asking the question. A 13-year-old young lady, what's your question? Sir. Yes.
So many TV shows follow patterns and happy endings, but Torchwood had very not happy endings, and Captain Jack made tough decisions. What was that like?
Well, the tough decisions were great because I love playing a troubled hero. I even see Malcolm Merlyn in Arrow being a troubled hero. Because he's actually doing exactly the same that Oliver is doing in series one. But slightly going about it quite differently by like blowing up the whole town. Sorry, spoiler alert. And making earthquake machines. So very different. But Jack, yes, and I'll tell you a story. There was this in Children of Earth when we did that. The little boy who played my grandson, his name is Bear, and Bear used to come. He would come up to me and he'd be like, "John, this is the day of filming the sequence when." Have y'all seen it?
Yes.
Thank God. When I sacrificed my grandson to the aliens, right? My own family member. Now I'll tell you the reason why, but I was in the grocery store, you know, as I was in the frozen food section. I shop for my own groceries. I do. Maybe not frozen food, but I was in the frozen food section. I was by Scott Light's fish fingers. Ladies, I'm not talking about that either. So, I'm in there, and this woman comes up to me, she walks past me, and I went, "Hello, Trent. I hate you." I went, "Excuse me? I'm just buying fish fingers." She went, "No, I hate you, but I love you, and you're confusing me, but it's a fabulous show, but you are a bad man." She walked away. I went, So there was a mixed emotion amongst audience members when they saw that. And Bear asked me when he was doing it. He said, "What should I do, John, when I'm on the pedestal and you're pushing that button?" I said, "Well, I'm just going to be watching you no matter what. If the camera's on you or on me. But tell you what, Bear, when it happens, just start shaking a little from your legs all the way up to your face. And makeup, ask them to give you a little bit of a blood thing that you can, when you move your nose or... when the camera's not on, you just do that, and it'll pop, and it will start to bleed out of your nose." I said, "People will go nuts, and they'll hate me." And he's like, "Okay." So he did. He shook, and the camera, when it would switch, they said, "Okay, Bear, pop the thing." It went boom, and it went trickle, 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 and everybody who watched it was like, "Oh, Captain Jack, you bad, bad man." But Jack, I always said about Jack, and the thing we always said about Jack when the part was written, he would do anything to save the human race. And the question for that series was, and if you think about this, if any of you were in a position in today's world, right, something happened, God forbid that it ever does, but if you were the person who could save the planet by sacrificing one of your own family, would you do it? Well, some of us in this room might do it, because we know we got family members that we'd like to fucking kill anyway. Or you'd find somebody. No, but you know what I mean? That was the question, because not many people would. And, you know, but Jack will take that responsibility on his shoulders. His family will turn on him, hate him, but he has to do it to save everybody else out there. So those decisions and the way that character was written was a kind of lush, kind of like trifle that was just great to play, because you had all this stuff that you could just feed upon. And every episode he was doing something that was either helpful or a hindrance, but doing it because, like when he gave the kids away in you know, the 40s to the 4, 5, 6. Right? Because they were using the children as heroin. I mean, come on, Russell, what were you smoking? So I love playing troubled heroes. So you're welcome. Yes?
Hi, I'm really nervous.
Don't be nervous.
First off, I just wanted to say I've been feeling a little tired and wired at the same time. I wondered if you had any suggestions.
Oh, no. Of those of you who've seen Shark Attack 3, Megalodon, I am not saying the line, but the line in that movie, the girl who I was working with, she had no personality whatsoever. Oh no, don't, she had no personality whatsoever. That's about it. And she even in the sex scene I did with her in the bathtub, it was like a wet noodle. It was unbelievable. What? It's part of my job, I have to do sex scenes. What are you going to look for? Yeah. But she was, but she just didn't give anything back. And I don't mean that in a rude way. She just didn't give anything back. So the director said to me one afternoon, just do this line, make something up, say something that's gonna get something out of her. So the line was, I thought the camera, you know, it was after we'd done the dialogue, and I said, yes, and I'm totally wired. What do you say I take you home and eat your beep? Right? Fill in the blank, another word for cat, okay? Well, I said it, and she went, girl, I've just given you the opportunity of a lifetime that no woman is ever going to get from me, and you're just looking at me like a blank stare. Well, I thought that's a joke, right? I went to go do the dubbing at the where would they do the voice dubbing and stuff to fix the movie, and we had to fix the whole thing. In B movie history, one of the most popular, and it's like number two in the best lines ever. And the writer's getting all the freaking credit for it. I made it up! But the best is when you go to watch it on the Sci-Fi channel or one of the other channels, and then they dub it, because I had to dub this in, and the line is, hey, I'm really wired and I'm tired, so what do you say I take you home and watch I Love Lucy? Hi.
I could just ask it real quick,
because there's a lot of people and you've already had a question, so just real quick.
If there's any literary character you could play, who would it be? We're librarians, that's why.
What?
We're librarians.
You're librarians? Ooh. Spank me. I really do. I think it's unfortunate that a lot of the libraries are closing and the cuts are going and the money's going elsewhere when we really need to keep the libraries open. So the people who are, sorry, my soapbox a second. So the people who are less fortunate and cannot purchase books because they're quite expensive have a place to go and get books. And my sister and I donate all of our books. If a library writes to us, we will give you the books for free because we want, so if you have a public library, please try and support it. It's a good thing. Anyway. The literary character. I would love to, oh gosh, it's gonna drive me nuts now. I can't remember his name. No, I don't know that. What's that book, the Gray movie? No. What is it? Stacey. No, I don't like that. No, that's not really me. Where he's got the painting in the attic. Dorian Gray, I'd love to play Dorian Gray. Because I got a painting in my attic and it's messed up. Yes, sir.
Was it creepy when it first appeared in the World War II with the gas mask child?
It was. Those gas mask childs are creepy, and a lot of people come up to me and they think it's funny when I'm at the table side and they go, will you be my mommy? I'm like, get out of my face! Very creepy, but you know what? When I was about your age, The thing that was more creepy for me, because I watched Doctor Who way back in the 1960s, that was before they had cars and television. People used to actually come into your living room and do it, and pretend. What are we gonna watch tonight? I don't know, but bring those homeless people in, because we're watching something fun. Three's Company 2. No, we had televisions. They were big boxes. Did you remember those? They weren't flat. Could you imagine that? Doesn't know what a big box television is. Yes, well, the odd times were my... Oh, I used to hide in Glasgow when my mom would walk me down the street, and after the Saturday night when I watched Doctor Who, and the Autons are the dummies with the shop dummies with the come alive and shoot people. They're even creepier in the old version than they were in the newer one. My mom used to have to put me inside her coat. Thank God it was a fur coat. That's what happened. It was the 60s, please. She put me inside her coat because I would not walk past the shop window with dummies in it because I was so scared. Yeah. So that was one of my scary moments, but doing The Empty Child was really scary. I also loved being with Davros, because that was like awesome. The one thing that I don't want to give anything away, but the one thing that I always wish that I was able to do as Captain Jack with the Doctor, I would love to have fought the Cybermen. I love the Cybermen also as a kid. I mean, Daleks are great. I have one in my living room, by the way. I do, and I had them fix it so that it's animatronic, so when someone walks by it, when you come into if it's at the front door at Halloween, it scares the crap out of kids. It just goes, stop! The cool nerdy kids get it, because the other ones are like dressed in those really ratty costumes, you know, well, I'm dressed like Uncle Bob, da da da. Only the superhero kids get it, right? And then the other thing is, when I have a party, it has a sensor on it, so that when people walk past, it goes, nice swagger! Welcome to Casa Barrowman! Be careful! Seriously, it's got a whole slew of things that it says. So, yeah, but the Cybermen. I love the Cybermen. They're awesome. Do you think they're awesome?
Yes!
Yes! What's your name?
Sammy.
Sammy thinks they're awesome! Woo! Thanks, Sammy. Yes?
Okay, I love that that question just came before me, because I'm dressed as Rose with
a gas mask.
But, so me and my friends who are here are huge Broadway fans, so we love everything you've done. You're amazing. And two of us actually gave up the opportunity to be in a production of Les Miserables right now so that we could come here to see you.
That's all right. There's thousands of productions going on around the country that actually you can pick it up anywhere.
So we're so happy to see you today. And first of all, actually took my question. I was going to ask you to sing, but instead, would you maybe give us one of your funniest or most scandalous stories from being on stage?
I'm not sure if I gotta be honest with you, I'm not sure if I did, because I never screw around during a performance. No, because the audience is paying so much money to see a show. My motto is don't screw around and have fun at the audience's expense, because if they see that, it really ticks them off. But if something happens, that's very different. I've been in a situation where something has happened, and anything goes. I used to, Martin Marquez, who played Moonface Martin, opposite me, we'd have a scene where we're in the prison, and he'd be lying in the bed, and I'd have to stand up, and oh, Hope Harcourt, I love you, Hope, and I hope you can hear me, Hope, and I start singing, all through the night, right, famous Cole Porter song, and as I get to the end of it, I'm supposed to go, all through the night. And I take a nice big breath before the night, so it's all through the night. So there's the pause. So I'm at that point, having sung the whole song, really given it Broadway, West End, I love you, Hope Harcourt. That means over the top. And I get to the point. and I go, all through. Martin goes, there's one guy who's Captain Jack.
Also, how's Russell doing? Have you been talking to him?
Yes, but I'm sure that Russell, I mean, he appreciates people asking and stuff, and he's doing fine, but that's something that's Russell's business, and I won't discuss that in front of everybody, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Great, no problem.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Eric.
Hi.
I'm a musical theater geek, too.
Really?
Yes, I know.
Good.
And I would be interested in knowing if there are some musical roles that you have not done that you are dying to do.
I'm not dying to do them, but I would love to, I will go back to the West End or to Broadway. I get asked all the time to do shows. And I have a deal with Ambassadors Theater Group that it stands at the moment that if I want to do anything, I go to them and they'll do it for me wherever, and then I can take it worldwide on tour, blah, blah, blah. But it's all about time. And the thing is, I'm enjoying what I'm doing in television at the moment, and I enjoy working in television because it also gives me more freedom to be with my husband. And I'm not saying that, and this is where people don't get it. People who work on Broadway and work in the West End, they are the hardest workers in the industry. They really are, apart from the crew and everybody who work on shows, because they do 8 shows a week. They get 1 day off a week, and they're working, from rehearsal time and then doing the evening shows, and it's a lot of work. But I would love to do La Cage again. I would actually love to do it on an American tour. I think it would be fantastic. We are looking into doing my concerts over here, but the problem is that most concert promoters don't know me. They know me as the guy on television who's in Doctor Who. It's kind of a double-sided coin. Doctor Who and Malcolm Merlin, but they don't know that I've had a 16-year career of singing and 9 albums and blah, blah, blah. So it's introducing them to that. But one of the promoters I know who does the conventions, we're actually talking about linking it up, that I do concerts on the first night or like the Friday night of the convention weekend. It's expensive to do one of my shows, and it's not because I'm just honest with you guys. I don't make a lot of money out of them. I do them for the fans, and I put all of my motto is put the money back into the show that I make. So what it costs me to do the show, I do earn a living, but not a lot from it. But the shows are expensive to do, so we have to find out a way without having to charge you guys, because you already pay enough to come to these things, right? So we have to find out a way to make it financially okay for you, but also I gotta cover the cost, because it costs like over $1.5 million to do a complete, you know, tour of mine. You know, that's just to get the trucks and everything together. That's only in the UK. That's not talking about here in the US, because you got so much more to factor into it. So we are looking into it. I really want to do it, and we'll see what happens, hopefully within the next year. But I'd love to play Mac and Mabel. Yeah.
Yes.
I'm going to continue the musical theater questions, and it's a preference. Do you prefer Andrew Lloyd Webber?
It's not a preference. You're born that way.
Do you prefer Andrew Lloyd Webber or Stephen Sondheim? And could you answer it by singing a portion of one of their songs?
Okay. I have to say, though, you cannot compare the two.
There's a right answer and a wrong answer.
Girlfriend, don't chuck challenges down on the floor when I've worked with both of them and know them both. Because there's two different, yeah, I'm teasing. Two completely different composers. One is more kind of, lush and lyrical, and although Sondheim's lyrics and music are very lyrical and in their own sense, they're very, you know, juxtaposed and all up and down and all over the place. I love Stephen Sondheim, I really do, obviously. And, being alive!
That's the right answer.
Yeah, but I do love singing Andrew's songs, because I was in Phantom, you know, I was in Sunset Boulevard. Sunset Boulevard was a fantastic, amazing show. And you know, I know you're shaking your head, but it's just different styles, and you have to accept differences. Yes.
Okay, first off, I did watch Dark Q, every single episode I watched, I liked it.
Good.
Even the ones with you in it. This is more
even the ones with me in it?
Definitely.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going
to. I like you more than the new one.
Okay.
Question about Arrow. Do you know anything about like your character? Are they going to bring back more of a vengeance issue because Tommy got killed in this? Or?
Ask me a straightforward question and I can answer it.
Okay. Your character.
Yes.
Is he going to be more vengeance-driven now because Tommy is now, the character Tommy's now dead?
I don't know.
can you compare the differences between Stars, working for Stars, and working for BBC? Which did you prefer as far as production?
I don't compare in that way because I'm an actor and my privilege is to work. And the fact of the matter, I love Torchwood, I love Doctor Who, I love Captain Jack. I know some of you are like, oh, it's gone to Stars, it's gonna change to become more American, blah, blah, blah. I don't give a shit, as long as it's being made. Because the integrity that I put into the work, the integrity that Eve puts into the work, the integrity the others put into the work, Russell, Julie, everybody, it's the exact same integrity as we did before, right? But things have to change. Because it's a drama, if it didn't change, as in characters dying, things moving on, we would be stagnant, it would be boring. And remember, I say this, but with all due respect, we're not just making it for the Uber fans, we're making it for everybody, because we want to spread that message out there, right? So if Stars comes along and says, we want to do it, because we're going to put the money behind it, hallelujah, go ahead and do it, right? If HBO come and say we want to do it, HBO, go and let's do it. I'm happy to always be working, and if Captain Jack is alive and Torchwood is alive, I'm happy. Yes.
Well, I watch this video like every time and I can't decide who's the luckier man. What was it like to kiss David Tennant? I know you don't do this, but can I at least find out, like, on the cheer person?
No, sorry. Okay. You're not a man. No, I'm kidding. They won't let me kiss.
It's okay.
Sorry. David Tennant has chronic halitosis. Really bad breath. Yeah. And he's got false teeth, which comes in handy. No, Dave's a good kisser. Dave's lovely. And obviously, you know, the question has been asked, but you know, my favorite—I will say—my favorite doctor is David Tennant. So there you go. Because he's Jack's doctor. He's Jack's. He's Jack's. Yeah, you get. Yes, question.
Okay, which novels?
Sorry.
Take
us through the writing process, because I don't know if you know, but my sister and I write, we've written the most current Torchwood novel, which is a great Captain Jack story, if you want to, and it continues on after Miracle Day, so it's the life of Jack continuing. My sister and I, the writing process, my sister does all the hard work. We lived, when we're doing a novel, we also have children's books, mid-grade reading level books, Hollow Earth series about Matt and Emily Calder. It's all about art and bringing themselves, their art to life and works of art to life by recreating, because they are animare, a sect of people who can bring artwork into the real world or bring the real world into the art. And we time travel on that too in a very unique way. It took us a long time to figure that out. But we, Carol comes and lives with Scott and I for about 3 months at a time, and we take notes, record everything. We write stuff down, we come up with stories. The first characters, like in the Hollow Earth series that we came up with, was, funnily enough, a deaf character called Zach. And he is the most communicative character because he, spoiler alert, he can communicate with the other kids through telepathy. So you don't realize he's deaf when you're reading the character until one day we say, he signs. And you go, what? Oh my gosh, he's actually deaf. So we wanted to do that and create, because we want characters in the book to be different from each other and still to celebrate their differences. But Carol takes all the information away from the 3 months. She goes away, she sits in a closet. I came out, she goes back in. And she physically writes the words, takes all the information, and she does the hard work. So that's kind of our process. But we do backstories, back history. You know, we do all that kind of stuff, and we have a great time. And that writing process, not only with Anything Goes, my autobiographies, but for me, my dreams have come true, and I have to say this before we wrap up, because I know they want me to wrap up. You guys need to know that you have made my lifelong dreams come true, and I know you work hard to come here, and you spend your hard-earned money, and that's why I think that we need to put on such a good show for you guys, because you've changed my life. You've given me everything I've dreamt about. So having said that, first of all, thank you very much for that. But because of that, my sister's dream was to become an author. So if I could help my sister become and live her dream, I then do that. And my sister, having written the books with me, we both were best-selling authors with the Sunday Times for 13 weeks. So she's a bestseller now. So it's an incredible thing, ironically, that you guys have given to me, and now I'm able to give it to somebody else. So I just want to say before we wrap up, I thank you very much. Scott thanks you, because you've changed our lives, and we totally appreciate it, and we will never, ever forget it. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you. No, I'm going left to right. Yes. Her mic's not on. Hold on, sweetheart. Now try it. Here, ask your question.
Can you tell us about
Thank you so much for being
this one.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Go ahead. Don't squeeze too much. I don't want to be wiping things up over there. Oh, like you didn't think I was going to go there. What's your question?
Thank you so much for being here. It means a lot to me. I heard you talk in Chicago, and it was just amazing to hear everything you were saying. I've been having some troubles, and you've really helped me out a lot. Like, I thought I was kind of a freak and that I should change for not being straight or cisgendered, and I was trying to change, and you really, sorry, my voice.
That's okay, this is the Oprah moment that I call, alright? This is your Oprah moment. Keep going. I'm not Dr. Phil, because I ain't that big and ugly. And sometimes I want to punch him in the mouth, don't you?
Yeah.
Shut the up, Dr. Phil. Nobody cares about your opinion. Anyway, go ahead.
It's just meant a lot to me, and I feel more comfortable, and you're just a big influence in my life.
Awesome.
You helped me out a lot.
Awesome. Well, are you done, or is there more?
Do you mind singing for us?
Inside, you helped me out in my life. I didn't know I was probably being gay. Da 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 da. Oprah moment. Can you sing for me? First of all, the first part of your question, I say, and I know I was quoted, and I probably will get the quote wrong, but don't ever apologize for being a nerd. But you know, what is it? Someone know the asshole line. Who? Anybody? Go. Right, don't apologize for being a nerd, because people don't apologize for being assholes. And it's the same way. Never apologize for being gay or for who you are, because you know what? We are no different than anybody else, and the world is going to change because we are going to be treated equally. And I'm one who's going to fight for you, stand up on my feet, and make sure it happens. Because in no way is somebody going to tell me that I am any less of a person or deserve anything less than somebody else, and I'm not going to stand for it, and neither should you. So good on you. What do you want me to say?
Pray Dr. Hitler!
No, I'm not saying this. Pray Dr. Hitler! Only in Dallas would you ask me to say that. Germany, and I was doing a con in Germany, and they're saying, Mr. Barrowman, this is my German accent, it's really good. Mr. Barrowman, I wonder if you could sing Springtime for Hitler for us. I said, what, you want me to sing that in Germany? Are you crazy? That would be all over the press, can you imagine? No way. I remember when we were filming the movie, and we were in New York in Brooklyn, and in the side of Brooklyn where we were, they didn't tell us, but we were rehearsing in this big parking lot. There's about 200 Nazis in the parking lot giving all the right? And I look around, I'm talking to a couple people, I go around to the fence, and there's all these Hasidic Jews standing watching us. Mel Brooks came in and he goes, Jesus Christ, get everybody in, we're gonna start World War III, if you know. Unbelievable. Oh, who thought? When I'm put on the spot, I know I sing a lot of songs, but I don't know really what to sing. Sing who? Sing Star Wars. Da, 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 da. Wait. Stop. Where's Barbara?
Dreamer.
Barbara. Oh, you don't know who Barbara is? Barbara and I go way back. Barbara, stand up, Barbara. Barbara started to come and see me when I was in musical theater in 1989, right at the beginning. Miss Saigon, actually, so it was right after. And I've known her kids, and I think Scott's over there, is he? Wave? Yeah, since they were yay high. And that's one of the reasons I came to Dallas. You never knew I had a girl in Dallas, did you? Me and Barbara, husband never knew, did he? was too busy playing golf. No, I like him too. Let me just tell you, they're a good Texas family. Hospitality. What should I sing? Dreamers? Okay, this is a very simple song. Dreamers have mountains they will climb. There are dreamers who don't believe in time. Only dreamers have dreams where they can fly far away. Some people dream of being rich, while others dream of being tall. And there are people who don't dream at all. Big finish. Sometimes you need to take the time to find treasures and mountains you can climb, and maybe you dream to stay the way that you feel. 'Cause to dreamers, the real world can be unreal. Trust me, I know, because I'm a dreamer. He is the face of Bow. Well, I say he is. When David and I were filming that episode, Russell, obviously we get this, we get the scripts ahead of time, and we, you know, like to read them and check out what's going on, and I hadn't read it yet. David came into my trailer, all of a sudden I heard this. I went, what? I said, John, have you read it? Have you read it? Next day at lunch, he comes back up to the trailer and goes, John, have you read it? Have you read it? David, I haven't read it yet. You won't believe it. Shut up, don't spoil it for me. No spoilers. So I have my lunch, I sit down, I read the script. Russell, hey, what's going on? What the hell were you smoking when you wrote that? Face of Bow, not in that. Yes, Face of Bow, what's really interesting and lovely about that is that Jack never, sorry, the doctor, I'm so out of breath now. I can't blame it on altitude in Dallas because it's as flat as a freaking pancake here. The doctor never agreed with who Jack was or what he was, right? And I know my story, Mugs. And the irony is that he was going to Jack for advice, for information, for ways in which to save human race, other races, and that was just a nice little twist that they did, so thank you very much. Yeah. Yes.
Hi. What was your reasoning and inspiration to do the dance for all the single ladies? And
could you do the dance? And what?
And could you do the dance?
No. Are you kidding? I can't even breathe right now. The single ladies actually came about. I did not do that. I did not do a dance to single ladies. Those were outtakes. All of those different dances, all that kind of stuff, was all me being silly between takes on a TV show that I produced for the BBC, one of my own shows, called Tonight's the Night. And the guys that do that, they started their own digital graphics company. And they took it and they said, can we do a little video as an homage to you and the show and something fun and also use it to promote our company? And I'm like, yeah, thinking, no big deal. Viral. it's like the most popular video of mine around, and that's how it came about. It's different dances, different sections, all spliced together, two single ladies. I never danced it full like that at all. But everyone thinks I did, and aren't I good?
Anytime someone asks me, who's John Barrowman, I just show them that video, but just watch this.
Say again?
Anytime someone asks, who's John Barrowman, I say, just watch this video.
Oh no, don't just show them that video, for God's sake.
Other ones.
Yeah, please show other ones. There's some really good ones. You gotta look for those.
By the way, one thing.
How many questions are you gonna ask?
No, last thing. Real quick. Hopefully, real soon. Equality, man.
Yeah. Well, I hate to tell you this, it's happening in other states, but it ain't happening in Texas yet, so you gotta fight harder. Yeah. Yes.
How did you feel when you heard that you were
going to
get your own show called Torchwood?
Yo! Well, how did I feel? It was actually both a sad moment and a very happy moment, because I was obviously in Doctor Who at the time, and Julie Gardner, our producer, everybody was in the offices, for the Doctor Who offices at the BBC. And there was the 7/7 bombing that afternoon. So London got bombed by the terrorists, and the buses and the tube stations. And I was doing a cabaret show that night at one of the big cabaret venues in central London. All of the West End shows shut down, and no one had any shows. I decided to do mine. I kept mine open because I believe that even if something tragic as it was, and horrific as it was, and how evil those people were, that you still need to move on and live with your life and show them that they will not stop us, right? So I did the show. And everybody came. Everybody showed up. It was amazing. It was in more ways than one, everybody showed up. Yes, they did. And I put on a big special performance for them. So Julie Gardner was coming that night to tell me, I didn't know that I was getting my own show, Torchwood. So it was a mixed bag of emotion. And after the show, she came, before the show, we had dinner. And we're sitting talking, she said, John, it's been going really well. We want to continue Captain Jack's life. And I thought, well, they're gonna tell me that they're gonna put me in more episodes of Doctor Who. And they said, no, we're gonna give you Torchwood. And I was like, yeah! But I couldn't show my excitement, because also she said, don't tell anybody. So I had to go on and do the show that night, knowing that information, not telling anybody, but I did text Scott, obviously. He was there, I told him after the dinner, and then Julie actually rode onto the back of Scott's motorcycle, and I've got some bribery for her, because it's a great shot. She's got a mini skirt on, she gets off the motorcycle, and it's like Britney Spears all over again. Anyway, thank you. Yes.
First, I want to thank you for doing Captain Jack. It was because of you that got me into the new reboot of Doctor Who. Because I was so trepidatious about the reboot. I didn't know if my childhood heroes would come back great. And I'm an idiot because Russell T. Davies is awesome. But my question to you is, which I just forgot.
See, sometimes it's not so good to do the little full-on or preamble before the question.
Oh, now I got it. Good. I'm good. Okay, what's going on right now, and when will you be back in Doctor Who?
Because what do you mean, what's going on right now? Like, right now, we're in a big room with lots of people, and I'm doing a panel.
So, you know my name already?
No. Okay. No, but I can time travel back in time 5 minutes. Find your name, I'll come back and tell you.
I'd say wait, it's time travel.
So, you want to know what's going on right now?
When will you be back?
I have no idea. It's not a question to ask me.
Is there anything going on?
I am not in control of that. Right. It's the BBC who are in control of that. And it's also the writers and the new producers who are in control of it. And I've always said I would love to be asked back, because I adore playing Captain Jack. It's a role that changed my life and changed a lot of people's lives. And it's up to them. So the people who are really also in control are the fans, who can write and ask. And it's up, they might just not ever do it, but that's their prerogative. It's a drama, things change. But even Arrow has said to me, if they ask you to go back, we'll let you go back and do it. So everyone's kind of game and open to it. But I would love to.
Yeah, we'd love to see you there.
Awesome, great. Next question. Yes, TARDIS.
This is gonna be very off
awkward because I was gonna ask basically what she just asked.
You stole her question! Yes.
But, anyways...
Do you want us to have a moment to think about a new question? That might be a yes, right?
Nah.
No, you got one already. Okay, go ahead.
I'm not gonna ask a question, but I'm just gonna say that I'm very honored that you came here today, and I like your character.
You like my hair?
No, your character.
My character. Thank you very much. Come over here, because I always have to do this to TARDISes. Or tarred eyes, because I'm the only one who ever was on the outside. Woo! All the other TARDIS dresses don't get up now. Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm really nervous right now.
Don't be nervous, just hold the microphone up to your mouth. Just, yeah, tend it to me. Please tell me you're 18. What's your question, dear? Say again?
You're fabulous and I love you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Just pull the mic out of there. Take Thank you. Thank you for helping her. Go ahead.
From the Dark Review Show or the Torchwood Show, which was your favorite episode so far?
I never answer favorite questions. Seriously, because once I say what's my favorite, that's it. It's done. I can never change my mind. So I never say what is my favorite show, whatever my so any of you who are gonna come up and say what's your favorite song, what's your favorite this, don't ask it. But I have had a lot of episodes that were really good and real a lot of fun to be in. In particular, I love the episodes. Of course, the first episode where Captain Jack appeared, the empty child, and Dr. Who. In Torchwood, I have to say the entire, all of the series and every episode is a love of, they're loves of mine because they're mine. The show is mine. You know, it was created for me, so I can't fault any of them. Even if some of you do, you can just piss right off. But I don't give a shit. Is that all right? Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. Yes.